Romans 10:9. If you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Romans 10:9. I'm going to invite Pastor up here, and he's going to introduce a few people to us.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Marcus. It is really great to be here with you today, and thank you for all those who are tuning in on the internet, and welcome to the Well Church. And I want to start out today by making two introductions. The first is Troy and Deborah Hughes, and if you guys would come on up, we're going to introduce them. One of the things we've been working on at the Well for a really long period of time through our nonprofit corporation is we are starting a counseling center. And we have hired Troy Hughes to be our director of counseling services. And Troy is coming with a long history, and we'll have a lot of time to share. No, that sounded kind of bad, didn't it? Yes. So I was thinking of like 12 things that I could say that would be hilariously funny but would be terribly inappropriate. So I won't say that. So, but Troy is going to be the director of our counseling center, and Deborah is his wonderful wife, and she's supporting him, and they both decided to come and be part of the Well Church as well. So we'll be looking forward to getting to know them and seeing them through the next 10 or 15 years. And so we are grateful to be here, and we're grateful to start this off. I want to pray for them as they're starting this counseling center so that we can reach into our community and help with the transforming through that healing love of Jesus Christ. So let's pray together and welcome them to part of our team here. Lord, we are so grateful for the way that you use us to build your kingdom. And so we pray, Father, for the ministry that's going to begin here. We pray that you will strengthen them as they find what your plan is for them exactly as they're leading out in this ministry together. And so I just pray that you'll lift them up and watch over them and care for them during this time of getting to know your people here at the Well. Thank you, Lord, for your call in each of our lives to reach into this community. I pray that you will strengthen us, embolden us, and encourage us to be your people. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks, brother. Yes, a long history of service. That's it. That's the word. Yes. Thank you. Thanks for saving me. Good job. Thank you. That's I might have to come and see you for some counseling. So, okay, all right. So, also today we have a very special gift, our guests who are going to share their gifts with us today, and it's a musical group that is going to lead us in worship today that has been with us for many times in the past, and we want to welcome today the group Two or More. Thank you for leading us in worship today, brothers. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Buenos dias. Let's all remain standing if you're able to this morning. Father, we do thank you for this opportunity as we gather together to worship today, both here and through live stream and just in spirit and in truth, most importantly. Father, we know that you are not limited to or cornered into a place where we can only meet you at one building or one location. Father, you are with us. You are Emmanuel, and your tomb is empty. You are alive, and you are well. You are a God that lives. No other belief system today can make that claim. Only the Christian can say that my God hears me. And so, Father, wherever we are right now, wherever we're listening, wherever we're gathered together, if you're in this time of worship with us, Father, show that person that you are a help in time of need, that you are the presence that they are looking for. And so, Father, speak, move, minister, renew, restore, refresh all of us this morning as we worship you today, spirit and in truth. Awaken us now in Jesus' precious name. The familia said, amen. Let's worship.
Sad power, strengthen me to stand. While this door is open, I will seize this moment. I will live this day of my life as a godly man. Lord, awaken me to your holy lights. Lord, awaken me to resist the night. Lord, awaken me to fulfill your plan. While the door is open, I will seize this moment. I will live this day of my life as a godly man.
Here we go, fam.
And may we this morning, Father, not just be awakened physically, but Father, also waken us up inside, Lord, to know that we're living in a time, Father, where it's in my lifetime, where I've never seen it more important to be a true witness of who you are by loving you and loving people around me. There's a lot of people, Lord, who are perishing without knowing who you are. There's a lot of people waving their banners, saying what we ought to do. On both sides, the right and the left. But Father, I know that your love, your mercy, your grace, your patience is why we're still here on earth today. I know there's a reason why the church is still here, Father. And it's your timing. You know the time. That last one who will say yes to you is still here on earth or may even still need to be born. But we know, Father, that it's because of your grace. It's because of your mercy, it's because of your long suffering that you're still here. Father, speak to our hearts. Help us to know, Father, that we may be the only Jesus that some people may ever see. So may we not occupy this time with anger, with conspiracy theories, with tinfoil hats and name-calling people. May we take to the airwaves, may we take to social media, sharing the love of Christ. Your grace and your mercy in our lives. May we smile. May people see who you are. Yes, your truth and your righteousness, but it's your love and your kindness that leads to repentance. So, Father, now just go before us this time. We thank you in Jesus' precious name. The familia said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. I want to share a song with you guys. A song called The River of Life. And this is a song that to me is just such a blessing, such a great reminder that the well that I drink from is an eternal well. The well that I draw from that fulfills who I am at the deepest part of who I am is only found in the things of God. Because God has fashioned me for eternity. God hasn't just fashioned me for 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, or 100 years, or in our grandmother's case, 105 years of life. Yeah, seems like a long time. But God is not thinking about just our calendar. He's not just thinking about our time. Everything God is doing has eternity in mind. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 says that God has placed eternity in our hearts. We long for the eternal. Our hope, our happiness in this life is not found in what you can see, touch, and smell. It's not found in a politician. So let up. God's going to win. We don't need to get all ticked off and all full of angst. I read these posts, and sometimes it almost makes me feel like, what does the world think about us right now? I feel like we're just got pitchforks and torches, and we're just sharing or just yelling at the top of our lungs. No one's taking our church away from us. No one's trying to take our church away from us. The politicians don't even know what they're doing. We have one enemy, and that's Satan. These people are dying without knowing who Christ is. This song here, to me, is a reminder that only God can satisfy what they're looking for. Only God can fulfill that longing deep down inside, beginning with me and with every other person that you see and are angry and infuriated with on the social media today. That person that you can't stand, that name calling, that politician that you call names, Jesus loves that person. Jesus wants nothing more than that person to be saved. So be careful. The mouth that you use, the words that you speak. I know I'm very careful with that stuff today because I know that when I point a finger at somebody, I have three coming right back at me. Let's remember the river of life that we drink from. It goes like this, guys.
Got a river of love flowing out of me, makes the lame to walk and the blind to see, opens prison's doors, set this captive free. And I've got a river of love flowing out of me, spring up. That life
That song sung in an upbeat country style of music. And if I was going to judge a book by its cover, I would have written that song off a long time ago. Because quite frankly, I didn't grow up with country music. I'm not a country person. I'm a city boy. You know, and I believe in keeping things real. If it's going to be believable, it has to be you. And in this case, if it's going to be believable, it has to be God. And so deep down inside, I knew when I was singing that song, especially when we lived in Nashville, Tennessee. Talk about it, sending a city boy out there. That was tough for me, but I went out of obedience. You know, they came looking for us. I didn't look for them. And we started recording and touring and doing all that stuff. And it was a neat time. But boy, I was happy to come back home because my roots are here. And when I sang that song, here's the thing. Every time I heard it, I remember thinking, country music, man. Until one day, I remember listening to that lyric and thinking to myself, this is not about the style of music. This is not about a demographic. This is not about the way a person's dressed or someone's appearance, the color of someone's skin. This is about the message. This is not about whether there's drums on stage and your church says, no drums on stage, no guitars on stage. A drum set can't sin, but the person playing it can. A guitar can't sin. A microphone can't sin, but the person speaking in it can. And the message, the heart behind that song was powerful to me. And so the message there, obviously, was I had to be humbled. I had to be shown. And the Lord said, you know what? I have a message that I'm getting forth through my word. And I'm going to be obedient to my word. I'm going to be diligent to my word. And he is. He's faithful to his word, not mine. Regardless of whether I sing that song in a pop, hip-hop style, an urban rap style, or a country version, or a cheesy 80s version like I just gave you. Be blessed, familia. Know that the God who is alive and well is there for us right here. And right now, in spirit and in truth, I want to do a song for you guys called Dwell in the House of the Lord Forever. And I mentioned our grandmother who lived to be 105. We are blood brothers. Many of you know that. Some of you may not know that. But we are blood brothers. And our grandmother lived to be 105. She gave her life to the Lord at the tender age of 95. And for those last 10 years of her life, she had a Bible in front of her hand. Or in front of her eyes and holding it with her hands and just reading it. Every day she traded in a religion for a relationship with God. Now, she still called herself a Catholic. And she said, I'm Catholic. I'm like, that's fine. You can call yourself a Catholic, a Lutheran, a Baptist, a Methodist. It doesn't matter to me as long as it's a Christian Trinitarian church. That's all that really matters here. Jesus is your Lord and your Savior. You want to come up to me on a 10-speed and tell me he's no longer the Lord or God? Then we have to settle that in the parking lot. That's a separate issue. But my grandmother began to walk with the Lord at the tender age of 95. And those last 10 years were just amazing to see someone's life be encountered by the Spirit of God. She was no longer concerned with how religious she had to be, but rather just reading the Word of God and let God feeding her soul deep down in the part of who she was. This song here just always reminds me of her because maybe be not too close-fisted in this life. May we not hold on to our ideas too much. May we not hold on to too much of our temporal ideas. We're finicky. But may we live with an open hand. Let the Lord take what is there and impart to us a sense of his eternal purposes in our life. And I'm beginning to see as I get older that it's about eternity rather than just my plan to go fishing this next Saturday in St. George, Utah. Now that's going to be fun. And it's going to be happy times, but it's not going to be joy. I'm learning that everything comes, everything goes, but the Lord is forever. And that's what I'm ready to hang my hat on to make me really, truly smile on the inside. It goes like this, guys.
Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Makes me lie down in green pastures. Even though I walk through this valley of the shadow of death, I will not fear evil, 'cause I know you walk with me. Jesus, you're with me. It's you that comforts me. Forever I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You prepare me a table for my enemies, anointed with spirit, yeah, yeah, yeah. My cup overflows with joy. And even though I walk through this valley of the shadow of death, I will not fear evil, 'cause I know you walk. Jesus, you're with me. It's you that follows me. Forever I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
This is the time of our service that we normally have our offering, and as you know, since the dreaded pandemic has come around, we've decided to change the way we receive our offerings. For those of you that are present in the sanctuary here, we have boxes available on your way out today if you'd like to donate there. Also, those of you that are watching on the internet, as you're live streaming with us, you can donate at theWellYucaipa.com. I'll get that right one of these years. TheWellYucaipa.com. And if you, there's a place right on the front of our website there that you can give your tithes and offerings there as well. So let's pray and ask God to, this is a time of worship. Our giving is a time where we recognize that the Lord Jesus is sovereign over all things, including our finances. And we enter into worship. This giving to God is an act of worship on our part. So let's pray together and let's see what God would have for us here. Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for this ability for us to come to worship you, Lord. And no matter if we're here or we're at home or even on vacation, Lord, you will worship with us as we worship you. And so I thank you, God, that we have this opportunity. I pray that you'll bless these offerings, that you'll bless those who are in need right now, those in our congregation that have financial burdens. Lord, I pray that you will provide for them in a miraculous way. Thank you, God, for how you do care for us so deeply. In Jesus' name,
Amen.
How many of you can say this morning that God has been good to you? Yeah? Well, this world has a barometer that they measure success by, you know? And as we sing this song, maybe just take a little inventory. You know, think of a piece of paper with a line in the middle on one side that says, the things God has done for me. And on the other side, the things people have done for me. And now sometimes, obviously, they're a little interchangeable in terms of, well, somebody built a house and the banker banked and did all the stuff for me and I bought the house and God blessed me with this home. And yes, I get that. I'm not trying to be, you know, all tripped out on anybody, but I'm just thinking on the most fundamental level. The things that we really, truly sometimes forget to thank God for that people have nothing to do with. Like that vascular system, that lung, that's breathing, that neurological system that's going on in our minds, the billions of things that are happening just to keep us alive right now that people don't have much to do with. Amazon doesn't have much to do with it. A new car dealership doesn't have much to do with it. A construction company doesn't have much to do with that. My son is one of those. He's getting ready to go off to medical school here pretty soon, and he gives me more information than I want to know about the human body. But it's an interesting, incredible design. And the designer this morning, we need to give thanks for what he's done. Father, we ask you now to just bless your word. Just Give us a word for today, Lord. Bless my brother. Fill him, Lord, from head to toe, Lord. Give us a word for today. Anoint him. May he be the oracle of your message, your word, your loving kindness. Whatever you want to do today, Father, have your way now. In Jesus' precious name, the familia said.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, thanks, brothers. It's great to hear from you. As always, it's encouraging and blesses our hearts. So thank you so much for being here. It's always a good blessing from the Lord each time that they've come and been with us, and we're grateful to have them. Just wanted to, Brandon is fine, and he's just taking a little vacation and getting some rest. So it is, we're so blessed to have such wonderful musicians all the time here, and so it's a great blessing in our life, for especially when we have guests come and be with us. If you have your Bibles, turn to Mark chapter 2, and we're going to be taking a look at healing from the Spirit is going to be what we're going to talk about today, about how God himself is the source of our healing, that healing from the Spirit. And we're going to talk about fasting, patches, and corn on the cob. All right? And you're thinking, well, my goodness, the pastor has lost his mind. Well, rest assured that happened a long time ago. That's not a new thing. But we are going to talk about those things today, and you'll see how they're related. As a kid, I was growing up. I grew up here in Yucaipa most of the time. I found myself engaged in two equal and opposite demanding tasks for most of my life. One was trying to stay out of trouble, and the other one was finding exquisite delight when my brothers got in trouble. And so that took most of my time in my life. And this involved a lot of skating on the edge of truth and throwing each other under the bus with me and my brothers. And so that proverbial bus that drives through, that phrase has been used a lot, throwing under the bus. It's kind of like thinking outside the box, the new normal. You've heard of all these overused cliches. We have decided thinking outside of the box here. Actually, I've decided this is a word that we're no longer going to use around this place because it's just overused and has become kind of trite. So if you want to think of a different phrase for that phrase, you have to think outside of the box for something else. So we're not doing that anymore. So, but anyways, as we were skating around this edge of truth and taking turns getting each other in trouble, it made life a little bit interesting growing up. But one thing that I've noticed, if we're not careful, as we have grown up into adults, living out our life of faith in Christ can devolve into this cycle of skirting the laws of God and carefully bending the truth into our interpretation of what truth is. And then skillfully, as Christians, I see a lot of times Christians throwing other Christians underneath that bus. And we find ourselves then trapped in this web of legalism and having to follow a whole lot of laws. And then that causes us to have a lot of personal guilt. And then we have that guilt, and it causes us naturally, we don't like that guilt, so we try to make ourselves feel better by finding fault in others. And so we get into this trap without regard really to our own culpability regarding the events that are happening in our life and surrounding us. And a lot of times we think that everything in life is due to what's going on outside of us. And we become observers in our own stories rather than participants. And we think that everything that happens in our lives is due to them out there. But the reality is we are actors in our stories. And God is using us to act within our stories to not just experience those stories, but to shape the story of those that are around us. But how does he do that? How does God do that? And how does he help us in the midst of that to find peace and comfort and restoration and healing for our own souls from his Spirit? And so that brings us
to our story today of fasting and patches and corn on the cob. Now, this story here today, Jesus found himself on the receiving end of people trying to control him because he didn't fit into their box. And so after many decades, actually probably as long as a century, this group of people were controlling the religion around the area that Jesus was born into. And this group of people were called the Pharisees. And the Pharisees were people who really tried to dominate people by making more and more and more rules to live by. In fact, by the time of Jesus coming around, there was about 613 different laws that everyone had to follow. Now, that's a lot of different laws. How many of you know all 613 of those laws? Nobody? Okay. Who can tell me who the all 10 of the commandments? Raise your hand. If you know all 10 of them? Okay. 3 out of you all. Okay, I know that all of you at home probably know the answer because you're hooked up to the Twitter net and you can find the answer to that. But the reality is we have a hard time following all of these laws. So you know, Jesus came onto the scene full of grace and truth. It says he's absolutely full of both of those things. Now, the Greek word for full means full. It means he was full of grace and full of truth. Now, it's easy to be full of one of those things or the other. You can be full of truth and you can become a mean person who it's just the truth and not really care. Or you could be a person that's just full of grace and everything goes, you can do whatever you want. Jesus was full of both of those things. And so when he came on the scene, he came into a world that was built on purely truth. There wasn't a lot of grace going around. And you could imagine that the sparks were going to be flying. So Jesus came on the scene and kicked them right into legalism. And we're going to see that the sparks that flew came about and it came to a head. And Jesus brought that to their attention by using an illustration about fasting, patches, and corn on the cob. So let's take a look at Mark chapter 2, verse 27. And we're going to look at Jesus and how he defines, verse 18. And we're going to see how Jesus, how he talks about the practices of the day and how that relates to God. So verse 18 is where we're going to start, and we're going to talk about fasting. Now, you know what fasting is, right? Fasting is not eating food for a certain period of time. And the Pharisees fasted twice a week. And they were very religious. On certain days of the week, they fasted, and certain days, they didn't. Now, fasting is really a wonderful thing, and it's something that I fully advocate, the Bible advocates, but personally, I can't fast from food, because since I'm diabetic, if I fasted from food, there would be tremendous ramifications of that. And so when I do fasting, I have to fast from other things, social media or electronics or things like that. You know, we all have to find things that we fast. And we'll talk about the purpose of fasting in just a moment. But the Pharisees, man, they had these rules about fasting. And so starting with verse 18, Jesus, remember, had been teaching and healing and calling people to follow him. And verse 18, it says, now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting. John the Baptist, his followers, were fasting. And the Pharisees were fasting. And some people came and asked Jesus, how is it that John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees are fasting, but yours are not? Why are you not doing things the way that we think things ought to be done? And I know none of you have ever thought that about another Christian. Why are they doing things differently than the way that I would have done it? That's not the way that I would have done it. It's not the way that I was taught. And therefore, these guys must be wrong. And that's what these guys were saying. In verse 19, Jesus answered. And he answered in a strange way. He said, how can the guests of the bridegroom fast while he is with them? They cannot, so long as they have him with them.
But the time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them, and on that day they will fast. Now, these Pharisees were legalists. As legalists, they believed that the path to God was paved by rules and by human effort. You're going to see that right up on the screen, right up here. The Pharisees being these legalists, okay, they were guys that they had laws, and you followed the laws, and that's the way you came to know God. And they asked the question, why aren't you guys fasting like us? And Jesus replied with a story about a wedding. It seemed like it didn't make much sense at all. Well, weddings are a time of joy, and especially in this culture, in the Jewish culture where they were, it was usually a week off of work for everybody. And it was a party. Jesus recently had made water into wine, and the party went on for a few days, and they ran out of wine, so Jesus made some more. It was a party time. Everybody partied for a week, and everyone was having a great time. Well, what would happen if towards the middle of that week, the bridegroom was kidnapped out of the party? It would cause a crisis. Everyone would stop the party, and they would begin looking, and some of them would be concerned, and so they would fast before God. So this is Jesus' first allusion to the fact that there's going to come a time that as the bridegroom of the party, the main focus of attention, he was going to be taken out. It was kind of a offhanded allusion to the fact that things were going to get serious. But while the bridegroom was with them, it's time for the party. We live in an era of the gospel. We live in this era of the grace that's made possible by the cross. But in the first century, before Jesus died, people were controlled by the demands of the Pharisees, which turned the laws of God into a way to control other people. In fact, the Old Testament, it only says there's one day that you fast. It was the day of Yom Kippur. And it was a one day. It was the only fast that was declared that was mandatory for everybody in Israel. But yet the Pharisees had made this into such a big deal, and they used it as a weapon to control people with. Eugene Peterson, in his book titled Traveling Light, he said this about legalists. He said, these are people who don't want us to be free. They don't want us to be free before God, accepted just as we are by His grace. They don't want us to be free to express our faith originally and creatively in the world. They want to control us. They want to use us for their own purposes. And the Pharisees had elevated their own tradition to the level of scriptural truth. And legalists will do the same thing to us today. And they believe that everybody has to tend to do everything the same way. Now, I was really glad that our brother up here was singing. Did you notice the guy that was singing up here today? He was wearing a hat. Now, I was thinking today that I was going to wear shorts to preach in. But I said, nah, I'm perfectly free to do that. But I didn't want to be offensive to you. I don't have a lot of sun on my legs, so they're still not looking really great at this moment. They're very nice looking legs, but just not really, they're just kind of pale looking right now, okay? So I decided not to do that but you know what? I'm perfectly free. Nowhere in the Bible does it say, thou shalt wear long pants when you preach. Doesn't say that anywhere. In fact, most of the time there, these guys went around wearing dresses. It's what we would call them today. I'm not wearing a dress to church ever. You can just know that that's true. But when did that become a thing? Some of you are wearing shorts here, and I'm glad. It's good. You may. Some of you at home are in your pajamas. And it's good that I can't see you. All right? We tend to believe that everyone has to do everything the same way. Now, some of you that were offended by the guy's hat in here, perhaps, what did his hat say? Free. he is greater than I. Thank you. It did. It said he is, and then it had the greater sign, and then I. You might have missed that point because you were so like, oh, he's wearing a hat. Oh, he's wearing a hat. He's wearing a hat. He's wearing a hat. And for you, that's a sign of respect. There was a time in the church that everyone had to wear hats and cover their heads when they were in church. It's cultural. We can't elevate these cultural things above the scriptural. Okay? We need to regulate our behavior by what the scriptures teach for us. I remember when I was a teenager and I would go to church and my mom would say, I would be getting ready to leave for church and I had shorts on and baseball hat. I get the double, but wait, there's more. I think the thing that really sent her over the edge is my boxer shorts were hanging out the bottom of my other shorts. And she asked me, "You're going to church in that?" Fair question. I said, "Yes, you're not even going to church." And so we would go back and forth, and we had a spirited discussion about that. And the reality is both of us were judging each other. And the reality is, both of our hearts were wrong, although in some of our hearts it was right, you know. And that's the problem with our hearts. They're not all pure and all good. It's this mixture that we got going on that causes us trouble. Because some parts of our hearts are really good and pure. Some parts of it are kind of yucky. And we have this whole mixture thing going on. And here we are in this world with a bunch of people that have really strong desires and ideas in their mind about what they think is God's will. And then we realize, oh, it's cultural. But I tell you what, when I pray, I take my hat off. Now, why do I do that? It's because I think that's the thing to do. And I don't know why. I didn't read in the Bible anywhere. It doesn't say take your hat off when you pray. But it's our social convention. And I wouldn't impose that on anyone saying that's the word of the Lord. So, going without food, fasting. I want to talk to you about that. It doesn't impress God. God could really care less, actually, what clothes you're wearing. He's seen you naked. He doesn't care. It's not about that to him. That whether you wear a hat or don't wear a hat or shorts or long pants or a dress or not a dress, that doesn't matter. That is not God's concern. He wants to know what's going on inside of your heart, and he knows what's going on inside of your heart. And that's the question we have to ask ourselves. So going without food doesn't impress God. The purpose of fasting is not to earn merit before God, not to get a brownie patch or something from God, not to get anything from God. The purpose of fasting is a means of aligning our minds with the mind of the Lord. It's putting aside that temporary feeling better so that we can see our need and we can let that need drive us to find out what God is wanting to do in our lives. It's kind of like the purpose of prayer. It's not to make God do tricks. Prayer is a way for us to align ourselves with the heart of God and discern his will for what's going on around us. And certainly there's a component of prayer asking for God's favor and asking for God to heal and asking God to provide. But the main part of prayer, honestly, is that God changes our hearts when we pray. So that's fasting. So this question of legalism, Jesus talked about fasting, and then he brought up this question of patches. In verse 21 and 22, he talks about patches. He says, "No one sews a patch of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. Otherwise, the new piece will pull away from the old, making the tear worse. And no one pours new wine into old wineskins," right? Have any of you poured new wine into old wineskins before? See, the Bible is right. All right, no one does that. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins. You know, it's like drinking a liter of Diet Coke and eating Mentos. Okay, you don't want to do that, all right? They'll blow you up. both the wine and the wineskins will be ruined. And no, they poured new wine into new wineskins. So these guys are having a real concrete issue about things, about this whole reason why you're not following the rules. And Jesus answers with these two crazy stories about fasting and patches. And the main thing we want to know is that, and you need to know, is that Jesus was talking about the law and the rules of God and the grace of God. And he's bringing those two into contrast and saying, what is it that's going to heal your soul? Is it following all the 613 Levitical laws? Or is it the grace of God working and changing your heart? And that's what Jesus is asking here. And so, did Jesus come to just fix or fulfill the law? Both of these analogies are illustrating this point. Here's the point, Phariseeism and legalism is incompatible with God's way of salvation. You are not going to be saved. You're not going to be healed in your soul by following a long list of things to do. You're going to be saved and you're going to be healed by a transformation of your soul from the inside out. So how does that happen? Well, when we ask this question, if Jesus came to fix or fulfill the law, a possible interpretation was that the law was good. But the way that they interpret the law is like a new patch on an old skin, an old wineskin. It just doesn't work right. And really what Jesus is saying here, the application of these two stories, Jesus is trying to tell them that I'm not talking about patching up this old system or refilling old wineskins. Something new is happening. Your inflexible, brittle religion cannot tolerate this gospel of grace that I'm bringing. You must discard it completely. So Jesus is saying this is something radical and it's different. It's not just about patching up some old rules and putting lipstick on a pig and calling it a horse. It's we're discarding this old, but I haven't come to destroy it. I've come to fulfill it. And so what does that mean? Well, let's talk about an acorn, okay? If you take an acorn and you set it on a table, a real stout table, and you take a hammer and you smash the acorn, you're going to destroy it. It's going to wreck it and it will be of no useful purpose. It'll just be messed up. But if you take that same acorn and you plant it in the ground, it's going to be wrecked as an acorn. It will lose its acorn-ness. But in 50 years, that acorn will be a mighty oak tree. And that is the fulfillment of the destiny for the acorn. Jesus didn't come to pound the law into oblivion. He came to put it into its proper place so that it can fulfill its proper role. So what is the proper role of the law? We're going to come to that in a minute. But what I want to talk about is this old garment and the old wineskins. In this analogy that Jesus brings up, it's the law and it's the religion of the Pharisees. Okay. That's the end of that point. Okay, so that's the religion of the Pharisees. It's a legal list of rules to know, to follow, so that you can know God better. That's the old way, Jesus says. But Jesus says, you don't put a new patch on that old wineskin. Do you want a new patch or do you want a new wineskin? And Jesus said, the new wineskin is the gospel of Jesus. See, he says this is something that's totally new and different. The gospel is way different than the law. The purpose of the law was to show us our sin. OK, okay? That was the only purpose of the law. We're going to come back to that in a minute. But the reason that the law came was to show us that we can't sin. Let's talk about the Ten Commandments. If I start going through them, you know, that you guys will realize that you haven't followed the Ten Commandments. You know, let me listen. What's the first one? Have no other God beside me. Have you ever put anything else before God? Meh. Oh, we're already hosed already. What's the second one? Don't take his name in vain. Strike two. What's the third one? Remember the Sabbath? Okay. Oh, see, y'all, you messed up already, man. All right. So there you go. We can't even remember them. Honor your father and mother. Have you ever said an evil thing about your parents? I never have. Of course, they're sitting right now. Oh, wait, what's the next one after that? Don't lie? Oh, rats. Okay, so the purpose of the law is to show us that we can't follow the law. Nobody, the New Testament says, was ever justified by the law. Because we can't follow the law. It's not possible. It's the whole purpose of the law is to just show us that we can't follow the law. That's the old wineskin. The Pharisees put a new patch on that old wineskin. You know, sometimes you think that new patch is just the gospel, but actually sometimes the new patch is the Pharisees trying to add more laws to the old one. So the purpose of the law is to show us our sin. The purpose of the gospel is to do something about the sin. Because it's a core level. That's why Jesus came. It's not to just show us that we're bad, because we kind of already know that. But Jesus said, hey, you guys are bad, and I love you anyways, and I'm going to do something about it. All right. So while God is merciful, he's also just. He's going to forgive us of our sins. But the penalty for sin has to be paid, and if not by us, then by someone else. And Jesus confronted the Pharisees to tell them that their solution to the problem that's caused by the law, the problem of guilt, their solution is defective. The Pharisees said, you have a problem of guilt because you can't follow the law, so here's more laws to follow. And so that just made people feel worse, and what they did then is they went around and said, oh, I feel bad, but look at them, they're worse. If you confront people on their sin, 99 times out of 100, they're going to say, yeah, so they're worse than I am. I hear that all the time. Jesus came with a profoundly better solution to the problem of guilt exposed by the law. He says, I'll pay the penalty of your sin on your behalf. Receive this gift that I'm going to give you by faith. So Jesus hung on a cross and died to pay the penalty that was due to you and I for our sins. And he gladly did it. So how does this work out in practice, this gospel of grace? We receive that gift, then what? Well, the answer to that is corn on the cob. Okay? Look at verse 23. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields. So I have this picture of amber waves of grain. Wheat blowing in the Kansas sun. Walking through, and it says that his guys, as they walked along, they began to pick some heads of grain. They plucked up heads of wheat and ate them. That is gross. Have you ever eaten raw wheat before it's ground into flour? It will break your teeth. It is not good. It's nasty. And I always thought all my life, these guys must have really been hungry. Because they're eating big hunks of wheat. You know, eating the chunks of wheat. Okay? So we're going to take a musical interlude for a moment. Okay, then, so it's so easy to get distracted. By the way, that happens all the time, don't even worry about it. All right. So, listen, they're going along. I have some news for you. I looked up the Greek word for this, grain fields. It's sporimos. It's grain that's ready to harvest. And in the common use in the vernacular of the day, it meant all kinds of grain, even corn. Now, that would make a whole lot of sense. If there was this ripe corn, you can pull that off and you can eat raw corn off the ear. And it's much better roasted on a barbecue with butter and salt. But you can actually eat it and it's okay. It's not bad. So see, that makes a lot more sense to me. So these guys were going through the field. They were hungry on the Sabbath day because that's one of the Ten Commandments. You keep the Sabbath. And they picked the grain and they were going to eat it. But that broke the rules because you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. And so by picking the head of corn, the ear of corn off and eating it, they were breaking the Sabbath rules. The Pharisees said, "You are breaking the rules." I think they said, "You," with a pointed finger. It's crooked, kind of like that. And the Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath? Sinners." Verse 25, he answered. This is what Jesus said back to them. "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar the high priest, he entered the house of God and ate the consecrated bread, which is lawful only for the priest to eat. And he also gave some to his companions." David, who was a type and a forerunner of Jesus, went into the temple and took the consecrated bread that was only for the priests, and he ate it, which broke the rules. See, God's law about the law is that the law was built to keep us safe. But the law was never intended to supersede over what human need was. And if you're starving to death and there's a piece of bread in front of you, God doesn't care more that that bread was consecrated to him. He wanted the people to be fed. And he put it on David's heart to go in there and break the technical law to eat the bread. Now, that's a dilemma. It was a dilemma for these Pharisees because everything in their life was built around this law, and you had to follow the law. And if you break the law, it's like, oh, you're not being pleasing to God. So there's three things about this you need to know. First, the Pharisees valued the customs of men over the law of God. These guys were legalists. The rule of the Pharisees was preserved in this document called the Mishnah. And in the Mishnah, they had all of the rules, man. And you know, just about the Sabbath alone, they had 24 chapters on how to keep the Sabbath. 24 chapters. Now, I bet that's a riveting read. How do you mess up the Sabbath? You know, the Sabbath is, hey, rest.
Well, we don't want you having fun. We're going to make some rules. So here's 24 chapters on how to rest.
That just doesn't make a lot of sense to me. So they valued the customs of men over the law of God. Second thing, God gave laws to his people to bless them, not to burden them. Every one of his laws alleviates the quality of life or restores your relationship after sin. You know, you think about it. Honor God above all else. That brings blessing to your life. Don't lie. That brings blessing to your life. Honor your parents. That brings blessing to your life. Don't murder. That brings blessing to your life. Do you see? God's laws are God's attempt to bless our lives. And if we follow the laws, when you build your society on the Ten Commandments, then that makes society better. That's why all of our courtrooms used to have the Ten Commandments. And now people want to take down the Ten Commandments. Do you know why? Because they want to break down the order of our society. and build it up on some other kind of society. And that's not right. God gave those laws to bless us, not burden us. The third thing was the law was given by God, and therefore God can never, or the law can never be greater than God. God's the one that gave the law. So the law can't be elevated above God. Do you know the Jewish people at this time, they revered the law above God. They did the same thing with the temple of God was the place that is actually more important to them than God himself. They, as long as they did the right things and obeyed the rules of the temple, everything was fine. So, someone's having a speech out there. So sometimes I just get distracted by stuff. Do you guys ever get like that? Yeah. You never do? Oh, okay. For me, sometimes it's the easiest thing. It's like, ooh, shiny stuff. All right. So let me refocus here just a second. All right. So God is the one who is above the law. In Christians, okay, sometimes as Christians, we do the same thing. Sometimes people elevate the Bible above actually knowing God. I know some people that are really experts in studying the Bible. They know the Bible 10 times better than I do, and yet they don't apply it into their own lives. That is putting the Bible and elevating the Bible above God. If you read this and you know everything about it and don't apply it to yourself, the word says that you're just a clanging cymbal or a banging gong. You really don't make much sense. And I see people that really know the word. You know people like that just know the word. There's other people that elevate church, and they put the church above God. And God forbid that we ever do this. It's lovely to have a wonderful, nice church to gather together. But, you know, having church is not the goal of what we're doing. Worshiping God is the goal of what we're doing. And we want to keep that right priority. So Jesus is the one who defines the parameters of our relationship with him. The Pharisees quote the law all the time, but in this simple statement that Jesus made here, he is going to, I'm going to read that in just a second here in verse 27. In this simple statement, Jesus is going to challenge their authority, and he's going to take it back because these people had stolen the Sabbath from God and totally perverted what its whole intent was. So Jesus defines the parameters then. He basically said to them, the Sabbath is not yours to corrupt. The Sabbath is not yours to regulate. It's my gift to my people, and therefore I'm taking it back from you. And so he redefined then what this whole thing about the relationship with him, what the parameters are in our relationship with him and how we come to that relationship with him. As he redefines these parameters, he's going to tell you exactly what that is in verses 27 and 28. Because he's the one that sets the conditions of how we come to God. It's not us, it's not our ideas, it's about Jesus. In verse 27, it says, then he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. The Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. Remember, Jesus had been calling himself the Son of Man? He says, I'm the one who's the head of this whole Sabbath thing. You guys are all trying to make all these rules. You have 24 chapters about how to observe the Sabbath. That is not the way you find God. So the question then, we just got to ask this question. You know, how do we find healing for our soul? And the Sabbath is a perfect example of that, a day when we stop our work to reflect and relax. And it's an example of how we find our soul, but it's not having a whole bunch of rules about how you accomplish that Sabbath. And I want to ask you two and give you two words here that many people will find how they're going to heal their soul. One is by the law, and one is by the gospel. And so which way are you going to find healing? from the law or the gospel? Well, in the law, words like do. There's something to do under the law. You always have something that you have to do. And then the law also accuses us. The Ten Commandments. While I was talking about the Ten Commandments earlier and how none of us like lived up to those, didn't you kind of feel that voice of condemnation? Like, oh man, I am not following these rules. And it leads us to a vocation. A vocation is a dedication of your whole life to try to follow all of these rules. And you just come up with this never-ending list of rules to follow and follow and follow and follow. And how do you find that peace and healing for your soul? So one word is law. Another law, another word that we can use is the word gospel. The law says do, it accuses us, it reveals our sin. The gospel says something completely different. The gospel of Jesus says done. Your salvation was accomplished by Jesus' death on the cross. And the gospel also comforts us. And I want to tell you something, Christian, you can rest in Jesus. Now, I love my granddaughters a lot, man. I love when we go up there to visit them and we snuggle and I read them stories on the couch. But if my little granddaughter, who's 8 years old, comes up and says, Pop, do you love me? I'd say, of course I love you. And then she would ask me again in another minute and say, Pop, do you love me? Of course I love you. And then another minute, Pop, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? And, you know, after about 2 hours of that, I would say, yes, I love you. Would you shut up? None of you would ever do that. I know. But after a while, but do you see how God would be if we keep asking him, like, God, do you love me? 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 You know what? He loves you. He loves you more than I love my granddaughters, and I love them with all that's in me, my whole heart. And God loves you like that. You can rest in Jesus because the gospel is done. It comforts us. And the other thing it does, it forgives our sin. Forgives you. All of the rotten things that you've ever done have been forgiven by Jesus Christ. So you don't have to keep trying to earn that forgiveness from him. So if we put these two words to find healing for our soul onto one chart right in front of us, we have on the one side the law that says do, and then we have on the other side the gospel that says done. We have on one side the law accuses us, and on the other side the gospel comforts us. And we have on the one side the law that reveals our sin, and we find on the gospel that forgives our sin. So those are the two words. Now I want to tell you two ways that people find to try to find healing for their soul. You can please people or you can please God. I'm getting less amenable to pleasing people as I get older. Now, all of you have an idea of what the perfect pastor is. Right? Okay. You're all looking kind of guilty right now, but you do. And then you measure Pastor Ron up against it, and you find that he's wanting in certain areas. And then there's another pastor somewhere else that people come to me all the time. You should be more like, you know, Pastor so-and-so. And I always wonder, well, why don't you go there? You know, but I never say that. That's kind of mean, but that thought comes in my head, I got to say, you know. But I'm wondering, you know, we all have, every one of you has an idea about what I should be doing in my life, right? And I have come I'm over 60 now, passed that marker a few weeks back. And so I'm thinking for the rest, you know, the next 50 years that I have or so, Lord willing, I'm going to please God. You guys are out of luck. Sorry. All right? I'm going to do what God has shown me to do, and I'm going to be who God has shown me to do. As your pastor, I'm going to do four things. I'm going to preach and teach. I'm going to cast vision. I'm going to lead leaders, and I'm going to hang out with people. That's all I do. All right? That's my job description. So, you know, that's what I do. I haven't been able to hang out with much people lately. This darn COVID thing is putting 25% of my job description at risk, all right? But listen, do we please people or please God? If we please people, it's based on works. We try to please people, it has to do with works. It has to do with being very active. It's all up to you. It's all on you. And it's a vocation. It's a full-time job. It's a calling in your life. And that's all you're going to do is trying to please people. And that's how you're going to spend your whole life. But if you want to please God, you do it by faith. And you do it in a receptive manner. You receive what God has already done. And it's not passive. Receptive is different than passive. Passive means you just sit there. Receptive means that you're open and you're seeking, but God is the one who gives and you receive from God. And the third thing is you rest in union with Him. See, that's the really important thing in your life, is that you can rest in that union with God. You can rest knowing that God has got it under control. So, pleasing people and pleasing God. If you see them all up on one screen at one kind of thing right there, you see pleasing people or pleasing God all on one. Sorry, I'll wait till the commotion's all done here. All right. We all good? Okay, good. So we see the one screen. Put the screen up there that says two ways to please people or please God. All right? Are we there yet? One more. There we go. Right there. We leave it right there. We please people or we please God. That is how you're going to find healing for your soul. And I'm telling you, the one about pleasing people on your left, you are never going to be satisfied in that. But if you learn in your life about Jesus and you learn to please God by faith and receiving and resting in the union with God rather than trying to fulfill 1,000 different laws, you're going to find the healing for your soul. Because with people, it's never enough. But with God, we see it's what Jesus said on the cross. Jesus said, "It is finished." And we can rest in that. So this kind of comes down to one question. Where's your focus? Is your focus on yourself or is it on God? And I believe that spiritual healing does not come from your own efforts. The law, that's my phone, by the way. I just wanted to let you know. So I'm just as guilty as anyone else, right? So, spiritual healing doesn't come from your own efforts. The law, fasting, observing the Sabbath, pleasing people, doing more works. The kingdom of man requires us to be either stronger or more clever or more spiritual than the next guy. You follow the law to please people to gain access to the kingdom of man. And it's like unshrunk cloth on an old garment. It's like new wine in an old wineskin. And it's like keeping the Sabbath for no reason other than to keep from getting busted. But spiritual healing comes through faith in what Jesus has already accomplished. And that, my friends, is where we need to rest and where we need to stay. We need to remember what Jesus has already done. The gospel is that Christ died to pay the penalty for your sin, to comfort your soul, and to forgive your sins. Our faith has a sacred purpose to it. Sacred means it's devoted to God. Listen, our faith is what pleases God. Just trusting Him. It's like my granddaughter knowing that I love her and just resting in that. Enjoy the stories that I read to her. She didn't have to ask me every 2 minutes. And she doesn't, by the way. I'm just saying that if she did. Okay? It's all that He asks. You can rest in your union with God. And by faith, you're going to find access to God's kingdom. And you're given the keys to the access to that kingdom by faith. You need the gospel to please God in order to enter the kingdom of God. And this is where you're going to find healing for your soul. Believe the gospel, my friends, because only in Jesus is there a way to find healing for your soul. So my question to you today as we wrap up here is this, very simply, are you putting your faith in Jesus Christ? Are you attempting to earn your way to God by your own efforts? So I want to encourage you today, commit your life to Christ. Commit your life to Him. Let Him heal you. Let Him bring forth what you need in your life. So let's all stand together, and we're going to pray, and we're going to ask God to watch over us this week, and we're going to sing one more song, and then we'll be dismissed. So let's pray together. Father, we thank you this morning for this chance to gather. We ask that you help us to just trust in what you have done, Lord. We ask for you to bring us rest in you, and we ask for you to watch over us, Lord, and to care for us and to bring us into that relationship with you. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, brothers, let's sing one more time together.
I don't need no stinking microphone. Or badges. God is good. Thank you for letting us be with you today, partaking in this time of worship and this time of just fellowship. Look at you guys. Came to church. You guys are the rebels, man. Normally when we get done, I always like to say, turn around and say hello and give somebody a hug. But today I was afraid. And then nowadays I'm afraid I might go to jail for saying something like that, right? God is good. Let's close with a song of celebration. I hope I remember the lyrics of this one. He's just trying to kind of, we don't use song lists. I don't like them. This is just a blessing, a song of celebration, knowing that we will be with the Lord forever and ever. Amen. This is a joyful thing to celebrate. Here we go, familia. Check it out. Guys, have a great rest of your day and a blessed week, and we'll see you soon. God bless.